initially, I when I was called to do the tour, it was in 76 when I was called to do the tour. The band initially was fed up with it. They didn't want to do it anymore. They wanted more money. And Elvis said, "Hey, you know, I'm paying a lot of bread. I don't see why I have to pay any more." And he got another band. So they sent each one of us, they have these tapes. They would make tapes every night, every show. So I had these tapes, and whoever they were sending it to, like to the guitar player, they would send nothing but a little teeny bit of leakage in the vocal and a lot of guitar, you know, just on this tape. So with me, they sent a little bit of vocal and a lot of drums. Then they sent me all the drum parts. All right, and they said, now you can make, because Nashville, you may be aware of, has their own way of writing out charts. So I wrote out my parts. I had 100 and some charts I had to write out. And so I wrote them all out, medleys and everything. And one medley that he had, like chart, was 20-some pages long. You know, so my way of writing it condensed it down to 3. You know, so anyway, I wrote the parts out. And the first, well, we went to Graceland to rehearse. And I came into town late one afternoon, and they picked us up. They said, all right, tonight we're going to go over and rehearse. We got there about 6 o'clock, and the drums were set up in the barn out in the back, you know, where he had a little gym and handball court and whatever, racquetball. So we're just sitting there, and about 2 o'clock in the morning, he comes down. And in his jogging-looking suit, you know, and he sat down, and he said, do you know the intro? It was real nice, you know, everybody's standing around drinking and doing whatever they wanted to do. And basically, it was for the new guys because half of the band had come back. They realized they weren't as hot as they thought they were. And, you know, that's a lot of money to turn down. So anyway, they came back. Burton came back. Jerry Sheff came back. Glenn D. stayed away. So David Briggs came in. Shane Keister, who's from here, he came in and he did it and I did it. Okay, so I did the introduction, and we did the 2001 thing, and I'm reading my part, you know, Elvis is sitting right here, and I'm reading the part, and I do the drum thing, we're going to C.C. Ryder, he sings 2 bars, he quits, and he says, okay, let's do Burning Love, and all right, we do 2 bars or 4 bars of Burning Love, and then he walked out. He got up and left, and real cordial, you know, very, very nice. Hey, man, that's great, man. I thought he was going for a Coke. I didn't know. He went back to bed, you know, and we're sitting down there waiting, man, you know, Felton Jarvis and Red West and all the people are standing around. And somebody starts singing Love Me Tender, and we're going through this, and we're going through that, and I'm going, okay. And now we're, I was supposed to have a rehearsal for 3 days. All right, so-and-so, pack all this stuff up. So they packed my drums up. I thought, well, they pack them up and set them up tomorrow, maybe. I don't know. So they said, all right, we're going to leave about 4 o'clock. You know, and now it's about 3. You know, so I got time to go back to the hotel, pack my clothes, and we're off. And we go to Johnson City, Tennessee. And so they said, Felton, I said, hey, Felton, what are we doing? He said, well, we're going to rehearse tomorrow. Great, you know, okay. So we get to the rehearsal, we get to the hall, and it's a big, beautiful place, and Elvis is not there. The band's there. The band just does a little sound check. They say, hey, that's great, you know, hey, a little bomb scare, everybody goes home, you know. So I'm still waiting for the rehearsal. Well, there's an 8 o'clock show, and there ain't no rehearsal, you know, it's play it cold. So I'm sitting out there, and there really was a bomb scare. They emptied the place out and brought all the dogs in, all the metal detectors, and they found a guy up in the rafters with a a gun, a rifle with a scope on it. So they hauled him off. And this was very typical of being around Elvis. This was, he had anywhere from 15, which a lot of people don't know, he had anywhere from 15 to 25 death threats a day that he had to live with. So all the bull that people put out about him carrying a gun and having a bunch of gorillas around him is not fair. It's not fair to the man. It's not fair what he did. And anyway, bad reputation about putting people down on stage. And I said, I got a home and I can get to it real easy. So I don't think it's fair you do that to people, and I wouldn't do it to you. So this is only stories I'd heard, you know. And he couldn't understand that. He really couldn't grab that. He couldn't understand why somebody would say that about him. But I didn't know. I'd never been out with him, you know. So when he stopped that first time, C.C. Wright, I thought, oh, Christ, here it comes. And I'm trying to think of where my ticket was and all of that. I'm going home, you know. I'm going to put my sticks on my Tom, and they can burn them suckers. I don't care. I'm going home. So anyway, I do the routine. He says, hey, London, what are you doing? I said, hey, man, I'm playing the part, you know. I'm reading, Jack. All I can tell you. So he says, watch me. All right. How the hell can I watch him and read, it's all written out. And I said, there ain't no way. And so we get to the same place again. Now, it's 10,000 people sitting out there paying good money to see a show. And so we started, he stops, and I said, uh-oh. And he said the same thing again, and I said, he walked back to me, and he stood right in front of the drums, held a cymbal, and he said, hey, man, watch me. What's the matter? And I said, hey, man, I'm reading the part. You told me to read the part. I'm reading the part. He said, hey, man, don't pay no attention to no parts. Just follow me. No matter what happens, follow me. I reached down here, 100 and some charts, and I threw them on the floor. I said, you got it. And the Joe Gershio, the conductor, he just went into a panic because there's all these horns are back here. I'm supposed to be going, I don't know nothing from no ba 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 da. So I play, Elvis counts the song off again. We start into it again, and we go. And when we get on the plane that night, we went through the whole show, cold. Shane Keister, piano player, this is great. We were doing this medley, you know. Elvis did the medley, all the old things, you know. And he finishes one song, and then he goes like that. And Shane's supposed to know what that means, right? And there ain't no piano part coming out. So Elvis looks around at him and goes back and talks to him for a little while, you know. So he gets out of the bit. Elvis quits doing the bit. Shane ain't reading either, because his parts have been taken away. He's watching me, so we're all watching him. That's it. All we see is Elvis's ass for 3 hours, you know, 2 hours or whatever. So we're watching him. So thing comes up again. He gets to the part, and he's going to go into Teddy Bear. Right? Shane, Elvis goes like this, and we ain't doing Teddy Bear. And Shane goes, and he says, and he stops the show again and tells Shane, no, every time I do that, don't mean we're going to do Teddy Bear. But Elvis also, he would do things like that because he was enjoying himself. He would play with you. And that's what I got into on the plane, you know, like about not reading the part. He says, because what happened about not reading the part was he'd stop and he'd be into, what's he? CC Wright, what's he? What you have done? Mm-hmm. He'd be doing karate stuff, right? He'd be doing making moves. And he wanted, every time he did that, he didn't care if it was in meter, he wanted you to play toms and, you know, just go nuts on the drums, right? I said, okay, Jack, that's what you want. And he said, no, man, it's going to be great, I'm telling you. And so you would just do that. that was not on the chart. Because he would do it in a different place every night. He might stop the whole band and then just decide to get in some stance and do some moves and cat moves and all this stuff, you know? And it wasn't on no part. You can't write that. What are you going to write? You know? Pausing, squatting, you know? What are you going to... So anyway, he didn't do it. And the parts are fine, but they didn't work, you know? It wasn't part of it. I don't know if I answered the question or not. I'm hoping I did.
Just one thing, that's why I said it. It wouldn't seem like you really need to do this.
Well, he expected everybody to know his music. So there were no rehearsals. And the last concert we did was an hour and 45 minutes long. And he did songs that even the guys that were with him had never done with him. So it was like, what key, what chord? No music, you just faked it. And he was out there for an hour or whatever time he was there to have the best time he could possibly have. Because in all reality, that was the only time he had to have the fun. And probably more of you know more about him being from here than I do, but it was the only time in his life he had time to have fun and do what he wanted to do. He had a lot of things to worry about. People running on stage. When chick run up on stage one night, stark naked, and just popped him right in the mouth, trying to kiss him, and he couldn't see her, you know, or he would have enjoyed it, I guess. I don't know. But he's standing there, and here's this microphone, and she hits the microphone. He was singing a ballad in a spotlight, hit him in the mouth, and he don't know. Maybe there's 20,000 people coming at him, so he immediately gets behind the drums, and I'm, because that's the most things out there, I guess, you know. And I told him, you don't get he kept calling me cold heart, but it was just too much to take, you know, when somebody shoots, it'd go through me before it gets him. And they would throw frisbees at him with things, sign this and do, and so he would be afraid, and he had a right to be afraid. Because when you get that many death threats a day, you have a reason to be wondering who's looking at you or who's taking a shot at you. Not to bring it down, but a lot of what's gone on is a lot of garbage. The man did what he did and did what he had to do. It could have been a lot worse. And he don't deserve the rap he's gotten because he ain't here to say something about it, you know. But anyway, thank you.